This is Vader Reviews. We are honored that you would join us. Before we begin, I want to recognize a brave hero of the Empire. As many of you know, a couple weeks ago my cape was severely damaged. This great man went above and beyond, giving us enough credits to replace my cape before we continue filming our fan film, Fallen Jedi. Igloss, for your gallant service to the Empire, not only will your name be featured in the end credits of our film, I now confer upon you the rank of Captain. You are a hero of the Empire, and I salute you. After filming a new scene for our fan film, as well as completing some visual effects shots, I finally had some time to sit back and read one of the stories out of the Star Wars Epic Collection, Volume 3. Is the Force with this book, or does it choke on its own aspirations? Let's find out as I review Star Wars, Darth Vader, and the Ghost Prison. Written by Hayden Blackman and published by Dark Horse Comics in a 5-issue run from May to September 2012. During Blackman's 13-year tenure at LucasArts, he worked as a writer, voice director, and even producer on such titles as Star Wars Starfighter, Star Wars Jedi Starfighter, the MMORPG Star Wars Galaxies, and The Force Unleashed 1 and 2. During this time, he also penned a myriad of Star Wars comics, such as Jango Fett Open Seasons, Star Wars Starfighter, and many others, including the comic adaptation of The Force Unleashed. Our story begins on graduation day at the Imperial Academy, where young Officer Two-Face here single-handedly outperforms his entire class to become valedictorian. He is congratulated by Headmaster Mollet here, and I gotta say, if this had ever been turned into a feature film, Sean Bean would have been excellent in the role. Later that night, we learn our protagonist, ironically enough, has some two-faced friends when they lock him inside an experimental fighter. But let's be honest here. When you've got a name that sounds like a Dabo girl from Deep Space Nine, you gotta expect a little teasing, because for some bizarre reason, they decided to name the guy Lorita. Well, our little disfigured dweeb here just has no manner of luck at all, because when he ejects from the fighter, he lands right smack dab in the middle of an attack on Coruscant, which proves to be more than a little inconvenient, since he's unarmed. We get to the good stuff as I wreck shop on these rebel scum, and the artwork by series penciler Augustin Alessio is particularly stunning in these pages. During the attack on Coruscant, the Emperor is poisoned with some space anthrax, which is where we meet one of my least favorite characters of the story, Moff Tracta, a mouthy little robo-turd who is essentially a ripoff of me and Winter Soldier. I mean, how many cyborgs with respirators does the Empire really need? So me and Two-Face head over to the Jedi Temple to search for a place to lay low while the Emperor recovers from his wounds. And after a wizard little action scene, we see a security hologram of the Jedi Council being their usual grumpy selves. Turns out the Jedi have been running Space Gitmo during the Clone Wars, a place known as the Prism. We head off to the Space Pokey, where a Jedi, who never learned of Order 66, is still standing guard, but she gets the point pretty quick. We release all the prisoners, and you know what that means, it's time for a death battle. After all the mayhem, Two-Face has a little heart-to-heart with Q-Ball here, where she essentially word-vomits her entire life story to him. It seems a little forced to me, personally. This happened earlier in the book as well, when Tracta and Two-Face just give their backstories to each other at random. I feel since they were trying to make a connection between Two-Face and Q-Ball, she could have been reluctant to talk at first. And given the officer's physical condition, she would naturally want to know how he got those scars, so to speak. And if he had told her of his dreams of becoming a pilot before he was disfigured as a child, this would have given them more of a natural connection since her father was a pilot. Their conversation would have felt more genuine, but this sort of just seems a bit McClunky to me. And this is coming from a guy who thinks talking about how much he hates sand is a good pickup line. Now that Two-Face has let the Suicide Squad out of Arkham, we head back to Coruscant to dish out some Imperial justice on these rebel scum. And while it is undeniably wizard, my one complaint is that they have me using force lightning on several occasions in this book. I'm basically wired like an old VCR at this point, so I never use lightning as it would short out my life support systems. But other than that, it's pretty wizard. The Emperor charges Headmaster Mullet with treason, another reason Sean Bean would have been great for the part, because it's not a good movie unless Sean Bean dies, and the Empire is saved. The Emperor is impressed by Two-Face, and even suggests he may be a worthy successor to me one day. And we have a bit of a falling out, I'm afraid. In the end, while I enjoyed parts of this book, and the ending truly surprised me, I did have a few Comic-Cons, so to speak. As impressive as the artwork is, we could have definitely used more variety in the character designs. I know clones are a thing in Star Wars, but this is ridiculous. Also, the Jedi and Cube all here look far too much alike. I do feel there was a slight missed opportunity here as well, given the title Darth Vader and the Ghost Prison. Since we were dealing with a secret Jedi prison, we could have had a bit more of a supernatural vibe if the prism had been a place to seal away force ghosts of troubled former Jedi. Being the Chosen One, I could have had the power to command these force ghosts, much like Aragorn on the Paths of the Dead from Return of the King. Since they were going for a more grim, slightly horror feel for this comic, making it a literal ghost prison could have been an interesting plot point to explore, instead of just making it Space Gitmo. And also, I know it's a small gripe, but it's bugging me. In Star Wars land, losing a limb really isn't that big of a deal, so why the crap doesn't Two-Face have a prosthetic arm? He's the valedictorian of the Rhythal Imperial Academy. He can afford it. And dude, half your face has been completely blown away. Shave the other half of your head, you look ridiculous. On a more positive note, the artwork is of consistent quality. I am drawn particularly well and have several moments to shine. I also enjoyed seeing the blend of prequel era locations, such as Coruscant in the Jedi Temple, with classic era Star Wars vehicles like the Lambda class shuttle. The Emperor's stealth transport was also highly reminiscent of Darth Maul's Sith Infiltrator, which is one of my favorite Star Wars vehicles of all time. So for its quality artwork and impressive battle sequences, I give Star Wars Darth Vader and the Ghost Prison a solid 3 out of 5 Death Stars. The Emperor is not as forgiving as I am. This has been Vader Reviews. Be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and hit that bell for notifications, and follow me on Twitter at Vader Reviews. Join the Empire today. You do not yet realize your importance. Share these videos, and together we will rule the internet. And always remember, you don't know the power of the dark side.